From New York, this is Democracy Now!
We are now learning of serious irregularities at this facility that are deeply concerning and demand a thorough investigation.
As Attorney General William Barr criticizes the conditions at the federal jail where Jeffrey Epstein was found dead in his cell Saturday, we'll look at why civil rights campaigners have been raising the alarm about the Metropolitan Correctional Center in Manhattan for over a decade.
For years, there has been an urgent situation at the Metropolitan Correctional Center in Lower Manhattan. Conditions there are dirty, decrepit. Many people there are held in profound isolation. Many of us have been trying to raise this question for years. And hopefully, one good thing that could come out of Jeffrey Epstein's death is real attention paid to the inhumane conditions at MCC.
We'll also speak to attorney Lisa Bloom, representing two women suing Jeffrey Epstein for sexually assaulting them when they are minors. What happens now that he's dead? And we'll meet two New York lawmakers who helped pass a landmark bill this week to allow survivors of childhood sexual abuse in New York to sue their perpetrators, even if the statute of limitations has run out.
I thought I was going to die without ever having spoken about the abuse that happened to me.
When you've been sexually abused as a child, it can take years or even decades to process what happened.
That's why we changed the law and passed the Child Victims Act.
Hundreds of lawsuits have already been filed. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The U.S. Justice Department has asked authorities in Gibraltar to halt their planned release of an Iranian supertanker seized by British Marines in July in the Trump administration's latest escalation of tensions with Iran. Iran condemned Britain's seizure of the ship last month, saying it was a violation of the landmark nuclear deal from which the Trump administration withdrew last year. Britain accused the tanker of transporting oil to Syria in breach of European Union sanctions. Iran retaliated days later by impounding a British tanker in the Strait of Hormuz. In China, hundreds of paramilitary soldiers have massed at a sports stadium in Shenzhen as pro-democracy activists continue to hold protest day and night in neighboring Hong Kong. Video shows scores of military-style vehicles and hundreds of uniformed members of the People's Armed Police Force in riot gear conducting exercises earlier today. On Wednesday evening, Hong Kong riot police fired tear gas to clear protesters who flashed laser pointers at a police station. Local officials threatened to jail protesters for life. And the ruling Communist Party's official newspaper called on authorities to use the, quote, sword of the law to stop violence and restore order. Meanwhile, President Trump offered to mediate a solution to the Hong Kong crisis, writing in a tweet, quote, I know President Xi of China very well. He's a great leader who very much has the respect of his people. He's also a good man and a tough business. I have zero doubt if President Xi wants to quickly and humanely solve the Hong Kong problem, he can do it. Personal meeting? Trump asked. On Wall Street, the stock market took its largest single-day loss since October, with the Dow Jones dropping 800 points or more than 3% amidst mounting fears a recession may be around the corner. The drop in share prices came as Germany announced its economy contracted during the last quarter and as news emerged of a key economic indicator known as an inverted yield curve that has preceded the last seven U.S. recessions. In more economic news, a new study finds corporate CEOs in the United States have seen their income grow exponentially over the past four decades, while ordinary workers' salaries have largely stagnated. The Economic Policy Institute found income for top U.S. executives has increased by 1,000% since 1978, even when adjusted for inflation. A typical worker's salary increased by less than 12% during the same period. CEOs at the 350 largest U.S. companies have salaries that are 278 times higher than their average worker. Among the biggest beneficiaries, the Walton family, heirs to the Walmart fortune. Bloomberg reports the family's combined wealth has reached $191 billion, with the Waltons earning $70,000 per minute, $4 million per hour, or $100 million per day. Facebook secretly paid hundreds of contractors to transcribe audio clips shared by users in private messages. That's according to Bloomberg News, which reports the practice rattled the contract workers, who were often subjected to vulgar and intrusive recordings and were not told whose conversations they were transcribing or why. In a statement, Facebook said the practice was aimed at improving its artificial intelligence transcription service, but that the company had, quote, paused human review of audio more than a week ago, unquote. An Irish Data Privacy Commission said Wednesday it's investigating whether Facebook violated European Union privacy laws. Bloomberg reported earlier this year that Amazon, Apple and Google similarly hired thousands of workers to listen to users' recorded audio. Mexico City's mayor has ordered the suspension of six police officers as part of an investigation into charges officers raped two teenage girls. The officer's suspension came a day after hundreds of women protesters marched on the offices of Mexico City's prosecutor to demand justice. Some of them doused Mexico's security minister with pink glitter, while others broke glass windows in the prosecutor's office. In the Mediterranean, a Spanish rescue ship is headed for an Italian port with 147 migrants on board after a court overturned the Italian Interior Ministry's order keeping the ship out of Italian waters. The ship, Open Arms, was trapped at sea for nearly 2 weeks after it was banned by far-right Interior Minister Matteo Salvini. Another rescue vessel, the Ocean Viking, has more than 350 migrants aboard a ship equipped to hold no more than 250 people. Both Malta and Italy have denied a berth to the ship since it rescued migrants over 2 weeks ago. Aid groups say more than 600 migrants have died at sea trying to reach Europe from North Africa. NBC News is reporting Immigration and Customs Enforcement, that's ICE, is holding more than 8,000 migrants in 13 new jails in Mississippi and Louisiana, a nearly four-fold increase since late 2017. It's believed to be the largest population of ICE detainees outside Texas. Meanwhile, in Pasadena, California, hundreds of protesters rallied Wednesday outside a federal appeals court, calling on judges to uphold an injunction against President Trump's attempt to end TPS, that's temporary protected status, for more than 300,000 immigrants. The injunction was ordered last October by a U.S. district judge who ruled Trump's move to cut off protections to people from El Salvador, Haiti, Nicaragua and Syria may have had a discriminatory purpose. On Wednesday, the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals considered the Trump administration's challenge to that order. This is Martha Arevalo, director of the Central American Resource Center.
This is just a temporary fix to make sure that families are not separated and that children like the little girl you saw here today don't have to make the choice whether to live without their parents in their country or to live in exile just so they could be with their parents. That is not justice. That is not the American values and principles that we have been sold. That is not right.
Police in Philadelphia have arrested a gunman who sparked an almost eight-hour standoff after he opened fire on officers serving a warrant for drug crimes. He shot six officers. A 36-year-old suspect was taken into custody around midnight after a SWAT team fired tear gas into the building where he'd been holed up. The man was reportedly heavily armed, had an AK-47 assault rifle. This is Philadelphia Mayor Jim Kenney.
It's aggravating, it's saddening, and it's just something that we need to do something about. And if the state and federal government don't want to stand up to the NRA and some other folks, then let us police ourselves. But they preempt us on all kinds of gun control legislation. Our officers deserve to be protected, and they don't deserve to be shot at by a guy for hours with an unlimited supply of weapons and an unlimited supply of bullets.
In Boardman, Ohio, the FBI says an 18-year-old man who frequently praised mass shootings online had 10 pistols, more than a dozen rifles, and some 10,000 rounds of ammunition when agents raided his home last week. Justin Olson was arrested after he wrote online he would, quote, shoot every federal agent in sight. The FBI says Olson also praised the 1995 Oklahoma City bombing and discussed violence against Planned Parenthood clinics. Olson's arrest came just days after mass shootings in Dayton, Ohio, and El Paso, Texas, left 32 people dead. Iowa Republican Congressmember Steve King made incendiary remarks about sexual violence Wednesday, asking whether, without rape and incest, there would be any population of the world left. Congressman King was speaking to a conservative group in a suburb of Des Moines defending his proposed bill to outlaw abortion without exceptions for rape and incest.
What if we went back through all the family trees and just pulled those people out that were products of rape and incest? Would there be any population of the world left if we did that, considering all the wars and all the rape and pillage that's taken place and whatever happened in culture after society?
Congressmember King's comments sparked a fresh round of calls for his resignation, not only from prominent Democrats and 2020 presidential hopefuls, but also from many Republicans. King has frequently shared racist posts on social media and has made allies of far-right politicians in Austria, Canada, and the Netherlands. In January, House Republican leaders stripped King of his committee assignments after he praised white supremacy in an interview with the New York Times. Planned Parenthood says it'll end its family planning program for low-income people next week unless a federal court blocks a Trump administration rule barring Title X federal funding for any organization that provides abortions or refers patients for abortions. Trump ordered the sweeping changes to Title X in February, and recently the Department of Health and Human Services ordered all Title X recipients to sign a pledge by August 19th, promising to comply with the rule. Planned Parenthood says it'll refuse. Acting President Alexis McGill Johnson said in a statement, and quote, unless the Ninth Circuit intervenes, this gag rule will destroy the Title X program, putting birth control, breast and cervical cancer screenings and STI testing and treatment at risk for millions of people struggling to make ends meet. Newark, New Jersey's water crisis grew worse Wednesday as authorities temporarily halted their distribution of bottled water to families whose tap water is contaminated with lead. Earlier this week, the Environmental Protection Agency told city officials to distribute bottled water as soon as possible after it determined water filters were ineffective at safely filtering lead from the water supply of thousands of homes. On Wednesday, state and local officials began offering free bottled water to 15,000 Newark households, and hundreds of people queued up in long lines in the summer heat for their allotment. But the officials stopped handing out the water after discovering many of the bottles had exceeded their Best Buy date. A new study finds tiny pieces of plastic pollution permeate the Earth's atmosphere, falling down to Earth in snowfall, even in the most remote corners of the globe. Samples taken off the remote Arctic island of Svalbard showed an average of nearly 1,800 microplastic particles per liter of snow, with pollution levels at some European sampling locations more than 10 times higher. Writing in the journal Science Advances, researchers called for more studies on the effects of plastic pollution on human health. They cited a 1998 study that found inhaled microplastics may contribute to the risk of lung cancer. And the world-renowned Swedish climate activist Greta Thunberg has set sail from southwestern England, bound for New York. She's coming to New York for the United Nations climate talks next month. The 16-year-old Greta sparked a global movement of weekly student strikes for climate last year when she skipped classes each Friday to stand outside the Swedish parliament demanding action to confront the climate crisis. Thunberg refuses to fly because of the heavy carbon footprint of air travel. She's instead making her ocean voyage aboard a 60-foot racing yacht covered in solar panels. Greta Thunberg hopes to be in New York in time for the UN Climate Action Summit on September 23rd, before moving on to South America for more UN climate talks in Santiago, Chile, in December. Just before setting sail, Greta Thunberg dismissed climate deniers who've launched an online campaign seeking to discredit her activism.
I'm not concerned about reactions. What I'm concerned about is whether we will do something or not, whether the people in power will react and act with necessary force.
To see our interview with Greta Thunberg, as well as her historic speeches to the United Nations and other coverage, you can go to democracynow.org. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Nermeen Sheikh. Welcome to our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. New questions are being raised about the death of Jeffrey Epstein after an autopsy found the accused sex trafficker had multiple breaks in his neck bones, including his hyoid bone. This according to a report in The Washington Post. Epstein was found dead in his jail cell on Saturday morning at the Metropolitan Correctional Center in Manhattan. Authorities had said Epstein had hanged himself. The president of the National Association of Medical Examiners, Jonathan Arden, who was not involved in Epstein's autopsy, told the Post, quote, "If hypothetically the hyoid bone is broken, that would generally raise questions about strangulation, but it is not definitive and does not exclude suicidal hanging," he said. Many conspiracy theories have circulated about Epstein's death, in part due to his close connections to many well-connected people, including President Trump and former President Bill Clinton. Epstein's death came less than 24 hours after hundreds of pages of court documents were unsealed with testimonies from former employees and new details of sexual abuse committed by Epstein.
Jeffrey Epstein's death has brought new attention to the staffing and conditions at the Federal Metropolitan Correctional Center, or MCC. Reports emerged Tuesday Epstein's guards may have been sleeping during their shift, failing to check on Epstein for 3 hours and then falsifying time logs. They were supposed to check on him every 30 minutes. Epstein had been on suicide watch last month, but was then removed. The warden at the MCC has since been reassigned, and two guards who were tasked with monitoring Epstein were put on leave, although it's believed that one of those people was not even a guard. We're joined now by Jean Theo Harris, a professor of political science at Brooklyn College, who's written about the MCC, Metropolitan Correction Center. Her latest book, A More Beautiful and Terrible History, The Uses and Misuses of Civil Rights History. Jean, welcome back to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us. So here you have an extremely wealthy, white, high-profile prisoner who dies at MCC. Well, this is not the first time someone has died there, but most significantly, as the description of this jail started coming out and the expressions of horror from around the country, how is this possible? You've been sounding the alarm bells for quite some time. Tell us about what you might call Barr's Bars, right? This is the Attorney General William Barr's jail. This is the jail that is not run by the city of New York, but by the Justice Department.
Right. So to clarify, right, MCC is a federal pretrial facility. It holds people awaiting trial in the Southern District of New York. It is run, as you said, by the Bureau of Prisons that is underneath the Department of Justice. Conditions at MCC have been horrifying for years. And in fact, my very first time on Democracy Now! A decade ago, we talked about conditions at MCC then. As we talked about then, as journalist Aviva Stahl wrote about in a searing expose last year, conditions there are dirty. The facility is decrepit. It's vermin infested. Things break. So sometimes elevators break and lawyers can't visit their clients. Stahl reported how often the sewage system breaks.
Well, in that piece itself, you in fact referred to the facility as a gulag.
Right. I mean, in many ways, it is hard, and I think it has been hard for people to wrap their heads around a federal jail in Lower Manhattan, on Wall Street, right, with conditions that seem akin to, right, a third world dictatorship. Right? Dirty, hot, too hot and too cold, fruit flies, mice, extreme isolation in parts of MCC. Conditions vary in the facility. Reportedly, Jeffrey Epstein had been moved to the special housing unit on 9 South.
That's essentially solitary confinement.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. And so, again, just to remember, these are pre-trial facilities. People are being held in solitary confinement before any conviction, before any trial. And, you know, most international bodies consider sort of extended solitary confinement a form of torture.
So just on Jeffrey Epstein, already in July, there was a report that he had attempted suicide or his cellmate had tried to kill him or attack him. We still don't even know what happened there, but that's when he was put on suicide watch. And then apparently psychologists said he can go off it. But even then, after coming off suicide watch, you're supposed to be in a cell with another prisoner with eyes on at least, what, every half hour. And how is it possible that this happened with him there? That he was alone for hours on end.
For those of us who have studied kind of the Federal Bureau of Prison, it is not unusual, the kind of lack of mental health care, the kinds of conditions that we've found, we've now heard about with Mr. Epstein. Insufficient mental health care. So, for instance, there is only one psychiatrist that serves both MCC and the sister facility in Brooklyn called the Metropolitan Detention Center that we had heard about this winter. One psychiatrist.
That was freezing.
That was freezing. People, again, report that oftentimes you're treated through your cell's flat. You're not even face-to-face. That he was put in solitary confinement after perhaps trying to kill himself is not—it should be rare. It should not be happening. But it's not surprising in terms of the way that the Federal Bureau of Prisons— often, like, what happens in these federal facilities and the kind of lack of sustained, serious sort of attention to people who might be showing suicidal tendencies, who might be having mental health issues. Studies show that suicide is higher in jails than in prisons. There have certainly been suicides in federal facilities, so much so that in 2012... in an absurd turn of events, the director of prisons, after a spate of suicides in federal facilities, wrote a letter to every inmate telling them not to lose hope. Mm-hmm. Again, an absurd way to deal with mental health care in the federal system.
Well, can you comment on the fact that often suicide watch is carried out, the people who monitor people who are prisoners who are, or people who are detained who are suicidal, are often inmates, not even prison guards?
Well, also, what happened to Epstein, as they are reporting, is that he was put in solitary confinement. And there is something that should be counterintuitive and counterproductive of putting someone who is having mental health issues in solitary confinement. And yet that is often what happens. Mm.
And could you speak specifically, you said a little about this, but this area, 9 South and 10 South, which is reportedly worse than 9 South, how are conditions there different from the rest of the facility of MCC?
So 9 South and then 10 South is even more isolating. It's solitary confinement. There is a recreation facility on the roof that some inmates can access at MCC, but often people in 9 South and definitely people in 10 South are not allowed up there. So much of my work has been about researching 10 South. 10 South, the isolation is extraordinary. There's a shower in your cell, so you shower in your cell. You might have an hour of recreation in a solitary cage, but you never go outside. You are often—they often cancel recreation, so you can go days without leaving your cell. There's a camera on you all the time when you shower, when you go to the bathroom on 10 South, so you're being watched constantly. There's a light on all the time. The isolation up there—and people are often held there for years. But we haven't taken this seriously— While this is coming as a surprise to the general public, people held at MCC have filed legal motions for years talking about these conditions. They've filed administrative remedies for years. The DOJ knew. U.S. attorneys knew. Judges in the Southern District of New York knew. And either they turned the other way or they allowed it.
Well, I mean, you've been trying to raise this with the media, for instance, for years. What was the response? Why didn't people cover this, despite all these legal cases?
So one of the absurd things about the past 72 hours is no fewer than 20 different news organizations, many of the sort of most major news organizations in this country, have, you know, emailed and tweeted at me, urgent, you know, can we talk to you? Will you come on? A number of those news organizations I had sat down with 5 years ago, 7 years ago, 9 years ago, saying there is an you know, there is a crisis in Lower Manhattan. When attention turned, thankfully, to conditions at Rikers, I talked to journalists saying, we need to look across the river also at MCC. Mm. And again, people looked the other way. Or people tried to research. Getting information out of the Federal Bureau of Prisons is extremely difficult. Mm. They make it...
Well, you could hear, absolutely, even this weekend, when they were trying to figure out what happened to Jeffrey Epstein. They would say, we'll be able to see the video, and then it turned out there are no videos on the cells, and then they said there are no videos. Was he on suicide watch? No one could figure that out.
Right. And then when you're trying to do kind of a broader pattern there, and you say, okay, we'd like to see, you know, administrative remedies from a number of prisoners, you know, often they're like national security, or that's too many, you need to narrow your scope, or privacy issues, or this is internal workings of, like, a government agency. So, so again and again, making it extremely difficult to get information.
Interestingly, El Chapo, who is also held there, said it's been physical, emotional, and mental torture.
Absolutely.
The Muslim prisoners who have been represented there, we've interviewed Gareth Pierce a number of times. Describe what she says about what people are saying are in this prison.
So a handful of years ago, after a long battle in the European Court of Human Rights, for 5 years, the European Court of Human Rights held extradition to the United States because of conditions both at places like MCC and ADX. Finally, they bowed to U.S. pressure in 2012 and agreed to extradite these six men. Gareth Pierce, legendary civil rights lawyer Gareth Pierce, comes over to meet with some of the men of her clients, and I saw her after she made that first trip to MCC, and she called it diabolical. Now, as we know, Gareth Pierce has been representing people for decades. She is no stranger to prison abuse. She is no stranger to the carceral conditions of people considered, you know, political enemies or reviled people.
People represented at Guantanamo.
And yet what she saw at MCC astounded her, right? The level of isolation, the level of uncleanliness and filth, the level of making it almost impossible to adequately represent the person, your client, both in terms of—so on 10 South, you can't have contact visits, anything. Many of the men on 10 South are covered by special administrative measures. SAMs restrict a prisoner's communication to the outside world, but it also restricts lawyers and immediate family members. So you're not allowed to say anything. If the prisoner that you are representing or visiting is under a SAM, you are not allowed to say anything that they told you. So to put another way, if you think something horrible is happening, you risk being punished yourself by saying, my client said this is happening to him.
Well, what kinds of prisoners? I mean, they're usually, what's extraordinary about this place, such high-profile people. Amy just mentioned El Chapo, but also Bernie Madoff and others. What determines, and of course, Jeffrey Epstein himself, why are such high-profile people, I'm sure there are others, held in 9 South or 10 South?
So people are held at MCC because they're being prosecuted by the Southern District of New York. And then the more dangerous the prisoner, the more kind of extreme the conditions get at MCC. So again, on 10 South, El Chapo was held on 10 South. A number of Muslims facing terrorism charges, some of whom are familiar names, but many of whom are not familiar names. Epstein was not held on 10 South. I want to repeat that. And allegedly, he was found, when he was found in a cell, he was being held, reports say, in 9 South in a special housing unit. Again, that typically means solitary confinement. But part of the high-profile nature of who is being held there is due to the fact that the case is being brought by the Southern District of New York.
What do you think, Professor Theo Harris, happened to Jeffrey Epstein?
I don't know. What I hope will come out of this is finally attention to the conditions there at MCC. I think we've seen a media spectacle in the past few days and all this interest to MCC. But I guess my question is this really going to shine a light on what's happening there? Or is this part of the kind of salaciousness of this story? So we're kind of titillated by the details at MCC, but then we're going to sort of let it continue? Or are we going to? And again, I think we can see what finally the attention brought to bear on Rikers finally led to some both changes there and hopefully more changes ahead. Will that happen?
Call for the closing of
Rikers.
Right,
the call, right. And hopefully that's going to happen. Similar kinds of light needs to be shown at MCC. It is not clear to me, despite, again, all the attention this week to MCC, but what I very much hope, what many civil rights sort of advocates and lawyers who have been trying to sound the alarm about MCC for years hope, is that this will finally force us to see what is happening in this high-rise dungeon in Lower Manhattan.
Right next to Wall Street,
right
interestingly.
Next to Wall Street.
We want to thank you so much for being with us. Jean Theo Harris, professor of political science at Brooklyn College, has written extensively about MCC. That's the Metropolitan Correctional Center. Her latest book is titled A More Beautiful and Terrible History, The Uses and Misuses of Civil Rights History. Now that Jeffrey Epstein is dead, what happens to all the cases against him? We'll speak with attorney Lisa Bloom. Stay with us. Portishead. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
We turn now to the growing legal battle being waged following the death of Jeffrey Epstein, who was found dead in his jail cell on Saturday. Epstein had been arrested in July for allegedly running a sex trafficking operation by luring underage girls as young as 14 years old to his mansion in Manhattan. While the federal criminal prosecution of Epstein will likely end, prosecutors can still pursue charges against any of his accomplices, including his friend Ghislaine Maxwell. Civil suits will also continue against Epstein's multi-million dollar estate.
On Wednesday, one of Epstein's alleged victims, Jennifer Rose, sued Epstein's estate. Maxwell, and three other unnamed women who worked for Epstein. Rose accuses Epstein of raping her when she was 15 years old and repeatedly sexually assaulting her. Rose filed the suit under a new law in New York called the Child Victims Act, which took effect Wednesday. The new law gives all past victims of child sex abuse a year to sue their abusers, irrespective of how much time has elapsed since the crime occurred. We're going to talk about that law in our next segment. But right now, we go to Los Angeles, where we're joined by attorney Lisa Bloom, representing two other alleged victims of Jeffrey Epstein. Lisa Bloom is joining us on the phone. Welcome back to Democracy Now!, Lisa. So you tweeted, predator Jeffrey Epstein killed himself. On behalf of the victims I represent, we would have preferred he lived to face justice. Our civil cases can still proceed against his estate. Victims deserve to be made whole for the lifelong damage he caused. We're just getting started, you tweeted. So explain how this all works and who you represent, Lisa.
I represent two victims of Jeffrey Epstein. One was 18, one was 20 at the time, 2004, when they were recruited by a young female recruiter to go to his home to give him massages in exchange for a couple of $100. They were promised they would keep their clothes on, there would be nothing improper, and that there would be future economic opportunities as well. They were young waitresses and models at the time, and so they did it. And on separate occasions, they went to his home where they were sexually assaulted by him. This dramatically changed their lives, caused them to have failed relationships, derailed careers. They gave up modeling. The trauma of child sexual abuse is well known to anyone who's experienced it, and it continues to this day. They were in a lot of fear during Jeffrey Epstein's life. They were afraid to come forward because of him and his powerful friends, but they did, and they reached out to me a couple of months ago, and we decided that the proper thing to do was to cooperate with the criminal authorities first to get him hopefully imprisoned for a long period of time. Once he apparently killed himself, we decided that it was time for the next step, which is civil cases to be filed against his estate so we could seek compensation for them. And I can tell you right now, this is, you're the first news outlet I am disclosing this on, that we are filing those civil cases today in federal court in New York under the sex trafficking law, which provides remedies on the civil side of things for money damages to victims of sex trafficking. And sex trafficking is simply anybody who's lured or tricked into any kind of sexual act in exchange for money or a promise of money. And so I think it very clearly applies to our case.
And Lisa Bloom, can you say, do you know who is in charge of his estate now? And also talk about the way these two clients of yours responded to news of his death.
I don't know who's in charge of his estate. We're filing the case. When that gets revealed, we will serve that person or persons. You know, when he killed himself, we were all in shock. And my two victims had very different responses. One said, I'm so angry at the jail officials who allowed this to happen. It took me so many years to find the courage and strength to come forward, and I did. And now I'm going to be deprived of seeing him face justice. She was hopping mad. The other one said, you know what? I kind of feel a sense of relief. He's gone. He's not going to hurt anyone else ever again. And I don't have to fear retaliation from him. You know, even in jail, my client was very afraid of him, what he might do, who he could reach out to through his attorney or his friends and come after her. So at least that fear is lifted. But I want all victims to know now is the time to come forward against Jeffrey Epstein, to reach out and get compensation for what he did. It's not the kind of justice of seeing him, you know, really get incarcerated and become accountable in that sense. But there's a lot of money in this estate, and I am a civil attorney. I'm in the middle of a big sexual harassment trial right now in Los Angeles, calling you from my hotel room on that one. I believe in getting compensation for victims. It can make a big difference to be able to afford therapy and your medical bills and career training and pay off your student loans and get out of debt. It can make a big difference, and so I really do urge people to come forward.
So Jeffrey Epstein claimed a net worth of more than $500 million when asking to be released on bail. But the lawyers for his accusers say that they suspect his net worth to be much higher. And they are looking to offshore bank accounts and his allies, including his brother Mark Epstein, for additional assets. Yesterday, the Wall Street Journal reported that the brothers are connected financially through investments in a 200-unit condo building on the Upper East Side of Manhattan. Can you talk about this and how you're going to find these hidden assets?
Well, I appreciate that there have been a lot of media attention to all of his assets, and in a high-profile case, that's very helpful. The Wall Street Journal and other financial reporters have really been digging in. Typically, an estate the size of Jeffrey Epstein's has a lot of legal machinations to try to hide assets, to keep them private, to keep them in trust, for example, rather than going through probate. But there is going to be a person or persons who will be the administrator or the executor of his estate who will be legally charged with marshaling his assets, gathering them all together, being transparent, at least before a judge and attorneys like me who are making civil claims. And so, you know, we may not ever know the full vast extent of it, but I think we will get to know a good chunk of it. And if anybody tries to hide assets or hide information from the court, they're going to be in a heap of trouble. So I am somewhat optimistic that we will be able to get full and fair compensation for the victims that I represent.
And Lisa Bloom, you mentioned one of your clients was fearful even while Jeffrey Epstein was jailed. Have other people now, following his death, other victims, contacted you?
Yes, we heard from about five additional victims in the last few days, and we're in the process of reviewing and vetting their claims. We have an extensive process because I do a lot of high-profile cases against a lot of predators. And so we do background checks, and we talk to people repeatedly, and we talk to their friends and family, and we check out everything we can. We especially want to talk to witnesses who they may have told contemporaneously 15 years ago. People often tell their mother or their best friend or their therapist, and we like to get all of the corroboration and information in place before we go forward. As you point out, New York has a new law for victims who were under 18 at the time that they were sexually abused, that they can bring a lawsuit at any age up to age 55. That just went into effect yesterday. But even if they were over 18 at the time, the sex trafficking law has a 10-year statute of limitations, and there are tolling laws, which mean that you can even extend that period, which is what we're arguing in our case, because the psychological damage was so significant, they were not in a position to bring claims until now. So there are a lot of ways around those time deadlines. It's something I've really devoted my life to, because it's our enemy in every case. It's every predator's best friend if they can just, you know, run down the clock and run out the statute of limitations. Most people believe that's wrong, and courts are finding exceptions. So it's going to be a very interesting case, the case that we're filing today.
Lisa Bloom, I wanted to ask you about a case a few years ago in 2016. This was a case that you were involved with. It was a 13-year-old girl, I think, at the time of the assault. She older, of course, in 2016, who alleged that Donald Trump raped her when she was 13, and she met him at a Jeffrey Epstein party. Now, this case sort of came up and then was pulled out of the legal system. And I think it was back in November 4th, 2016, that you tweeted, "Jane Doe instructed us to dismiss her lawsuit against Trump and Epstein today. Tough week for her. We wish her well." Can you explain what happened in that case? And is that case being brought forward again? Is this a real case?
So I know that case is very disturbing and perplexing to people, and it is to me as well. I worked with her for months that summer, going through that same background process that I just described to you. I met with her many times. My staff met with her and talked to her witnesses, et cetera. And as the election was approaching, we thought it was very—she had already filed a lawsuit via another attorney on the East Coast. And when we thought, as the election was approaching, it was important for her to speak out because she had allegations against then-candidate Donald Trump. She was hesitant, and, you know, it was a yes, it was a no. And finally, one day, she said she was willing to do it. She submitted to an interview with CNN, but they never ran it. That was very upsetting to her. And so we decided to have a press conference. Unfortunately, we got a lot of death threats. My law firm website was hacked. My emails were hacked. My staff came in and told us about that, and she got very upset, understandably, and would not go forward with the press conference. She wanted us to drop the case. The attorney who was handling that was instructed to drop the case. I told her to sleep on it, you know, really think about this, which she did, and she stuck to that position. She wanted to drop the case, and she did not want to ever to discuss it again. She did not want to do any media interviews. She just wanted to be done, and that was, as you say, 2016, so coming up on 3 years ago. I haven't spoken to her since. She has changed all of her address and contact information, so I don't have that anymore. And, you know, this kind of thing is very disturbing, but it does happen. I've spent 30 years working with sexual assault victims. It's very common. This was just a high-profile case, but people just want to be done. They want to go away. Her case was not tested in court, so I really can't comment on it any further, other than I definitely believed her. She passed our background check process, but she doesn't want to be involved in any of this.
And again, she was alleging that it was Donald Trump who raped her when she was 13. She met him at a Jeffrey Epstein party. And what has since come out in Epstein's case is that he would hire people to intimidate women who had come forward.
That's right. That's right.
And so, Lisa, can you talk about the what cases can be launched against his co-conspirators?
Well, yes. So in our case, we are also today naming a female recruiter who came to my client's place of work, a coffee shop, and recruited them. We're not naming her, and that's because we think that she may have been a victim as well. So it's a very tough position. We are putting her in the lawsuit. We intend to serve her with the complaint, but we are inviting her to participate in a restorative justice proceeding with my clients where she can be transparent and open, where we can get information against her, not only for my victims, but for other victims that surely she recruited as well. So we want some measure of justice against her, but our primary focus is against the estate of Jeffrey Epstein. The recruiters can be held responsible under both the sex trafficking law and the child sexual abuse law in New York that you referenced earlier, and I think they should be held responsible.
And apparently they have found Ghislaine, if that's how you pronounce her name, spelled Ghislaine, but Ghislaine Maxwell, the daughter of Robert Maxwell, the former owner of the New York Daily News, who died mysteriously at sea in the early 90s. They found her at, what, Manchester by the Sea in Massachusetts?
Oh, well, that's news to me. So the recruiter in our case is not Ghislaine Maxwell. It's a different young woman. Apparently, he had many of them. But Ms. Maxwell has certainly been named by a lot of other victims as being held responsible. And, you know, what can I say? I think she needs to be brought to justice. She needs to be held accountable for her role in this. You know, surely she knew what was going on. She's alleged to have been really an integral part of bringing victims to Jeffrey Epstein to be sexually assaulted.
And Lisa Bloom, you've been calling for, you've suggested that perhaps out of the $500 million that Epstein is allegedly worth, if not much more, that a victim's compensation fund should be set up. Can you talk about that?
Yes. So I don't know who his beneficiaries are, probably his friends and family. I'm going to assume that they're better human beings than Jeffrey Epstein was, which is pretty low bar, and that they may want to voluntarily do something for the victims. So I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt to do the right thing in the first instance and to set up a victim compensation fund of, let's say, $500 million, where victims can come forward with their attorneys, like me, and present the evidence that we have put together to show that they're credible and they're real claims. They are who they say they are, and they were in the place and time that they say. And let them get compensated out of a fund. We don't need to have years of litigation over this and to put the victims through that trauma. The estate has the opportunity in Jeffrey Epstein's death to do the right thing by his victims, something that he never did in his life. And I would assume that everybody associated with him is mortified and embarrassed what he did and that they know him. So here's a chance to do right by the victims.
Lisa Bloom, we want to thank you for being with us. Civil rights attorney at the Bloom Firm represents two of Jeffrey Epstein's alleged victims. When we come back, we'll meet two New York legislators who helped pass a landmark bill this week to allow survivors of childhood sexual abuse in New York to sue their perpetrators, even if the statutes of limitations have run out. They, too, are both survivors of child sexual assault themselves. Stay with us.
Too free, if that's possible to be. No safety is what I mean. No solid foundation to keep me. Try again.
The Wolf is Getting Married by Sinead O'Connor. This is Democracy Now! I'm Mimi Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
Hundreds of child sex abuse victims filed lawsuits in New York on Wednesday. Under a new state law, the Child Victims Act, survivors of childhood sexual abuse in New York who previously could not bring their perpetrators to court due to statutes of limitations will now be able to do so for the next year. Lawsuits were filed against the Catholic Church, the Boy Scouts, a number of schools and hospitals, as well as the estate of Jeffrey Epstein.
The Child Victims Act was signed into law in February. This is part of a PSA released by Safe Horizon on the Child Victims Act. It features Assemblywoman Yulee Niu, Assemblywoman Radhanice Bichat, and Assemblywoman Catalina Cruz. It begins with New York State Senator Alessandra Biaggi, who joins us after this clip, all four survivors of child sexual abuse.
I thought I was going to die without ever having spoken about the abuse that happened to me. When you've been sexually abused as a child, it can take years or even decades to process what happened.
That's why we changed the law and passed the Child Victims Act.
The Child Victims Act means that survivors have more time to bring our abusers and the institutions that may have protected them to justice in the courts.
For more, we are joined by two of the lawmakers in that video, New York State Senator Alessandra Biaggi, who represents parts of the Bronx and Westchester, and Democratic Assemblywoman Yulee Niu, represents Manhattan. Both women spoke publicly about surviving child sexual abuse while explaining their vote in favor of the Child Victims Act at the state capitol in Albany in January. State Senator Alessandra Biaggi, Assemblymember Yulee Niu, we welcome you both to Democracy Now! Senator Alessandra Biaggi, talk about what drove you to push for this law, your own experience, and what you hope happens with this now. I mean, hundreds of lawsuits have been filed since yesterday.
I mean, that fact alone is just remarkable and shows you what is possible when you actually do fight for the things that you know are right and what the law can do. And so this law is something I campaigned on. It's something that is personal to me. I am a child sexual abuse survivor. I spoke very briefly about it in my campaign video, but I had not really spoken out as publicly as I did when I stood up on the floor of the New York State Senate in support of the bill. One of the most important reasons why I spoke up about it is because silence and shame are surrounded by abuse and the trauma that it inflicts upon individuals and the loneliness and the darkness that can really encapture your entire being if you stay silent was something that I was done with. I am 33 years old today. I was 31 years old when I spoke out against what had happened to me. And I really did think I was going to go to my grave with this inside of me. And something happened in my life that really just propelled me to speak about it. From that point forward, I really have not only felt liberated, but felt like one of the things I could do was use my voice so that other people who had experienced this could also understand that they too could speak out against it if they so choose.
And Assemblywoman Yulee Niu, can you talk about your own investment, your own interest in having this passed?
I think that it's a very convoluted answer, but I definitely feel like because of the history of not just the seat that I sit in, but then also the fact that, you know, I had to hear, you know, year after year, the bill not passing. You know, this is my third term, and we passed it my second year, but with a lot of different language. And I think that in conference was the first time that I had spoken about my own experience to any of my colleagues because, you know, we were hearing a lot of conversation about, you know, whether or not it was an attack on institutions, whether or not, you know, people were, you know, going to remember what happened to them. And I told them, you know, this is something that I will never forget, that I live with day to day, and that it still affects my life over and over again, every single time that I touch on it. And that goes through relationships, that goes through my relationships with friends, family, partners, et cetera, right? And I think that people don't realize the long-term effects and the impacts that it has on people. And people don't realize that with traumatic incidents like these, you know, I think that memory is something that is imprinted into you. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's part of why I spoke up.
So, State Senator Biagi, tell us what this law does.
So, the Child Victims Act extends the statute of limitations for victims of child sexual abuse in civil cases to the age of 55 and in criminal cases to the age of 28. Probably one of the most significant parts of this bill is what was triggered and began yesterday, August 14th, 2019, which will extend until August 14th, 2020, which is the look-back period of 1 year for individuals who were children who were time-barred by the statute of limitations in New York, who could not bring cases against any institution or individual because the statute of limitations had expired. This one-year look-back will allow for so many victims of child sexual abuse to be able to bring cases if they so choose, if that's what that's the form of justice that they want. And what we've seen in only just one day is upwards of almost 500 cases. And we know that there are hundreds, if not thousands more. And I think that this is just underscoring the significance of how many people are affected by this, of how important it is to provide protection in the law, and also of how we have to make sure that we are preventing this from happening in the future. Child sexual abuse is something that most people don't speak about until they're upwards in their 50s. And so I think that we have to be very real about this. The fact that this law is trauma-informed and acknowledges that reality is very important, and it's also something that I think about daily when I'm thinking about policy changes or policy decisions, because we want to make sure our law is trauma-informed.
We had Sister Helen Prejean on yesterday, the well-known anti-death penalty activist, but we asked her about what this means. Yes. We had her on the day that this law was going into effect, yes, particularly around the Catholic Church. I mean, do you expect to see scores of lawsuits around the Catholic Church? An adult who says 40 years ago, mm-hmm, this happened to me.
I do. And I think that, you know, we've heard so much backlash. And, you know, I was raised Roman Catholic. I am not as religious as my parents were. I don't go to church every Sunday. I did not get married in a church. I was just recently married. And those are very intentional things that I've done. It's actually very disappointing to be brought up in a faith that has really just betrayed so many people and ruined lives. And so one of the things that I find to be really upsetting is that the Catholic Church, specifically Cardinal Dolan, has spent, I believe, in the past year, $2.1 million on lobbying efforts to kill this bill. These are the lives of human beings. When you stand on the pulpit and you preach the gospel and the word of God, you speak about things that are trying to protect individuals. You preach about love. That is the opposite, the antithesis of love. And so, you know, institutions like the Catholic Church that have found it very hard to be authentic and truthful are going to have to face their day in court. And whatever the ramifications of that are, they are, because the people who are coming forward deserve their day in court. And that extends also to the Boy Scouts. It extends to any educational institution. You know, we also are part of the legislature, right? And the legislature in Albany has had a real troubled history when it comes to abuse. And I think that this year marked a very different journey towards speaking about this abuse, being very forthcoming about it. And we want to make sure as legislators that we hold space for that, that we are allowing people to speak up and protecting them.
Assemblywoman, we have 10 seconds. Do you want to see this law as a model for legislatures around the country and for Congress?
I do. I think that the one-year look-back period is so important. I think that we actually should have extended it.
We're going to leave it there. New York Assemblywoman Uline Nu and New York State Senator Alessandra Biagi both spearheaded the Child Victims Act, which took effect on Wednesday. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh, our website, democracynow.org.